10 years ago, she wrote a book about traveling the red state. She's currently working on one on the problems, questions, issues of older women activists. She's been involved in KALW, which is where I suspect most of you know her, from since 2001, and been the moderator of It's Your Call since 2006. And with that, I give it to Rose.
Spoken to he has made that clear. And when David Campos tried to run a campaign against the establishment for state assembly, they did that. They did every kind of nasty personal attack. Imagine, I lived in that district, some of you did. You saw the stuff that came out. And they were doing two things. One was they were saying, we want David Chu because he's more like us. The other thing they were saying is, don't dare mess with us, because this is what's going to happen to you. Right. So there's that climate of fear. Now, the mayor is considered very popular. If you look at the polls, everyone says the popular entry. But it's really important, and most, I hate to say, most of my colleagues in the political press, most political reporters don't have any support. Right? They look at the top line. Approval rating is high. Approval rating is down. Approval rating is up. You see all these White House polls, right? That's not what's going on. Right? Lots of people think the mayor is a good guy. And he is a decent guy. I know the mayor, well, I don't know him well, but I talk to him all the time. I know what he's saying. He's a decent guy. Unlike some previous mayors who we've had who were very elitist snobs, and he talks to people and he used to drive a cheap car and he lives in a little house in the land park. He's a good guy. Right? I used to hear the same thing, by the way, about Ronald Reagan. He seems like a good guy. And maybe a good guy. But when you ask people, do you like his policies? Do you like what is happening to the city right now? The numbers flip. The vast majority of people in San Francisco don't like what is happening to the city right now. So what we need to do as progressives this fall and into the spring, and God knows if somebody's got a record Democratic County Central Committee, so we can turn that messed up body around. For those people who believe in the Democratic Party, this is not a non-election. And the message I want to send you is this is not a non-election. There are very important things on the ballot, as well as the mayor's race. It will give you a chance to weigh in on what you think, not of Ed Lee the person, but of the policies that Ed Lee and his cronies have put in place in San Francisco. Okay? It is known, how many of you are renters in this room? Most are renters. How many of you wake up in the middle of the night worrying about being evicted? Right? Most of you. Because that's the fear. The people live in fear. The politicians are in fear of Ron Conway. The rest of us are in fear that we're going to have to leave the city because we're going to be evicted. Right? And that's a very real, this is an unsettled city, right? People are not happy with the way things are going. They see great wealth being created. They don't see it being spread around. Right? So how do we say something about that other than voting for one of these two candidates for mayor? Which, while I think is a fine idea, we all know the overwhelming likelihood is, given the world we live in right now, that they're going to be reelected the next mayor. Right? That's just the reality. So what do we do? Well, there's actually a referendum on the Ed Lee administration going on this fall, and it is not the mayor's race. Right? I mean, it is the mayor's race, but it's beyond the mayor's race. Right? One of those issues is the Airbnb initiative. Right? The Airbnb initiative is extremely important, in part because I believe in regulating the tech revolution. I believe that Uber and Lyft and Airbnb and all these other companies, these innovative companies, need to be regulated just like everybody else. They need to follow the same rules. And Airbnb is not. It is decimating housing stock all over the city. Tommy can talk better about that than I can. This is a real problem. It's not the person who a few nights a year rents out a spare bedroom to a visitor who they want to meet from another country, or somebody who, during the summer goes away for 2 weeks. It's people who are buying up entire properties, elementary evicting all the tenants and turning them into hotels.
True.
Right. And it's happening all over the city. People don't like this. People don't like it in the Mission, but they also don't like it in Westport. And they don't like it in the Sunset. And they don't like it in West of Twin Peaks. And there's a lot of neighborhoods across the city. Ed Lee is a huge fan of Airbnb. Ron Conway is a big investor in Airbnb and has skin in this game. If Airbnb in San Francisco is not stopped but regulated, it's going to cost Ron Conway money. And Ed Lee is on the other side, very clearly. He is on the other side of that Airbnb initiative. The second one is the Mission Moratorium. Right? The Mission Moratorium is, if you aren't familiar with this, the Mission Moratorium falls in my mind like a Hippocratic oath. First, do no harm. Right? The Mission Moratorium is about, let's not wreck things any more than we already have. Let's take a breather. I got it. Come on. Let's take a breather and try to figure out a better way to preserve this neighborhood. Right? That is something that the mayor has not supported, and it's not his support. Right? The third is District 3. Right? District 3, whatever you think of Aaron Peskin, some of you may have liked him as a supervisor, some of you may not have liked him. I didn't always agree with Aaron. Aaron Peskin versus Julie Christensen is a referendum on Ed Lee's administration. Absolutely 100%. It also will change the balance of power on the Board of Supervisors. I've been watching the Board of Supervisors meetings the last few months, and it's 6-5, 6-5, 6-5, on everything. screw up, clean power as that. It's called the, you know, whatever, it's about, you know, telling you what the city's doing, that it's nonsense, it's put on by PG&E. The mayor ought to be out there today opposing this, raising money against it. It's his clean power as that. It's the city, that's getting screwed up by this. I have not heard word one out of the mayor's office. I have not seen a dollar raised by the mayor in opposition to PG&E, because this is the mayor who went out there a couple years and said, PG&E is a great company. It is a great local company. Like Airbnb is a great local company. So we should bow and give fealty to all these people. So, this fall, if you want to work on one of the campaigns for mayor, two of the people who are in the room here, that's great. But there are other ways also to express your feelings about the mayor, and it's Airbnb, the Mission Moratorium, D3. These are going to be close. These are going to be very close races, all of them. They're all going to be really important. And if we can say, this fall, in what is going to be a low turnout election, 6,500 votes will change the district. That's what we think. 6,500 votes will elect the next supervisor and determine the balance of power on the board of supervisors. That's not a lot. That's people knocking on doors. Right? We can do this. And if we can do this, we can send a message very loud and clear, even if we're not looking at either of my two colleagues here in the mayor's office, unfortunately, next year, we will still have the ability to say, we have made a statement in San Francisco that the way things are now is not acceptable.
Is Tommy Avicolli Mecca. He's a longtime peer activist and housing rights and affordable housing advocate who's worked for the Housing Rights Committee of San Francisco for the past 15 years. He recently helped set up Jazzy's Place. It's a shelter for the LGBT community. And Marty's Place, a co-op for low-income and homeless people with AIDS. If you can, go online and search for Jazzy's Place because, well, Tommy's been posting some amazing articles on his Facebook page about the people who are going to Jazzy's Place. Tommy is also a singer and author of the book Smash the Church, Smash the State, the early years of gay liberation.
Tommy. Oh, can you hear me without standing up? Okay. I gotta hold my paper right here. When I just heard a question of him about how progressive can use the mayoral race, I have to think back to 1999, the Tom Amiano write-in campaign against incumbent Willie Brown. Gabriel Holland and I decided to draft Tom to run against Brown because the city was in the grips of, guess what, a housing crisis, the first dot-com boom, and Brown was doing absolutely nothing to help the folks being evicted and priced out of the city. In fact, Brown had said, if you don't earn $50,000, you shouldn't live in San Francisco. I'm not making that up. In other words, fuck the poor and the working class.
Fuck Brown.
I was not hoping Tom jumped in at the last moment. And in two weeks, we got him into a runoff against Brown.
Right.
Immediately, there was international attention on the race, and we used it to focus on housing issues and the changes that were happening to the city that were not positive. That campaign was actually centered in two neighborhoods, the Castro and the Mission. Tom didn't win, of course, but we turned local democratic machine politics upside down, and we mobilized a lot of folks who had never been involved in politics before, creating a groundswell that resulted the following year in the election of a majority of progressives to the Board of Supervisors. That's not going to happen this year, unfortunately. As Tim said, I won't repeat what Tim said, Tim nailed it. It's not going to happen this year. What I think we need to do, though, to bring attention to our issues, is what we did in May and June. We need to bring people to City Hall and make our demands known loud and clear.
Right.
On May 8th, we brought 1,000 people, most of them from the Mission, to City Hall to demand that the city do something about the affordability crisis. We knocked on the mayor's door, and guess what? He couldn't be bothered to open it. On June 2nd, we brought 800 people to the hearing on the proposed moratorium. A group of black ministers led the contingent that went to the mayor. The mayor announced that his housing bond is going to include $50 million for affordable housing in the Mission, and that 490 South Van Ness, right up the street from where I work, has now been purchased by the city and will be 72 units of affordable housing for families in the Mission instead of the luxury condos that were proposed for that site. Meanwhile, the Planning Commission has come up for a proposal for interim control that is actually a very, very watered-down version of our moratorium. That was the result of our repeatedly going to the Planning Commission and telling them that we didn't want luxury developments such as 490 South Van Ness, and because word has gotten back to the commissioners that we had shut down the last three community meetings that developers have held in the Mission. We shut them down. Not just the hardcore activists like myself. That was family. That was teenagers. That was young people. That was teachers and union workers and the people who live in the Mission. They shut them down. These concessions from the mayor's office and the planning commissioner are not enough. See? It's not enough. It's not enough. 72 years of housing at 15 to something is nothing, right? And these interim controls are nothing. $50 million will not buy much affordable housing. But it shows that we had an impact, okay? But we're not going to stop until we stop the Mission and the Monster at 16th and Mission and the Beast O'Brien in the 200,000 block of Bryan Street. What it shows is that people power can work. We need more direct action. We need to show up at their offices. We need to do more of these kinds of things during this mayoral election. We need to put the mayor and his administration on the spot. Debates aren't going to cut it. We need to shame this administration publicly, which is what we did on May 2nd when we brought those 800 people. Because as I said, we brought people from the Mission, ordinary people, ordinary neighbors, family members. Imagine if the hate and Soma and the Castro and Chinatown and North Beach did the same thing. What if they all brought 1,000 people from their neighborhood to City Hall and made the same demand that they want a moratorium in their neighborhood and they want nothing but 100% affordable housing in their neighborhood? Imagine. But this is what we as progressives have to do, because the electoral political system does not work. In fact, the reality is that the system, period, does not work. It's broken. It only works for the rich. We know that. We've known that. We can't have illusions about the system. We can't band-aid it, which is what we constantly do. As much as I support the moratorium and the Airbnb break, the reality is they don't go far enough. We need to do more. What we need to do is be relentless. We need to not let the decision makers, whether it's the Board of Supervisors or the Planning Commissioners, off the hook until they give us what we need to stop the evictions, to stop gentrification, to be self-sufficient with living wage jobs, affordable housing, and health care for all, and safety nets that guarantee that we remain self-sufficient. We need to call out this city and force it to deal with class issues,
right,
and economic justice. As a human right. As I said, we can't rely on the politicians, no matter how left-wing they are, no matter how great the rhetoric is. We have to rely on ourselves. We are the power, not City Hall and not the politicians. These issues are bigger than this mayoral race. These issues are bigger than ballot measures. These issues are about taking back our city. These issues are about taking back the land in this city. And we do that via vehicles like the Community Land Trust and co-op. We do it by taking the land off of the free market, because the free market only benefits the rich. Real estate people get control of the land. They don't know the land is not there. The land belongs to all of us and none of us, okay? And we got to take it back. We have to take back our and the system will become more and more about the 1% and less about the rest of us. Thank you.
That people should know about.
What is coming up? Yeah, I mean, we're more targeted. We certainly want people to get involved.
There's something coming up on August 13th at the Mission Neighborhood Center from 6 to 8, a fundraiser for the Mission Moratorium. August 13th from 6 to 8, we're going to raise $250,000. To defeat the $3 million campaign they're going to spend against us.
All right.
And in September, there's going to be a hearing on the Bryant Street, the 2000 block of Bryant Street, where they're going to tear down the whole block, which is now artists to do because they want to build condos. There's a hearing on September 10th where we want to mobilize hundreds of people to be at that hearing and do what we did as the Board of Supervisors. And if necessary, if they vote in favor of it, we want to shut down the planning commission.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Our next speaker is Amy Farrah Weiss. Amy is running for mayor. And Amy has supported individual and political well-being through research, education, and education for nearly 20 years. She started a nonprofit called Neighbors Developing Divisadero, which supports inclusive and sustainable neighborhood development. Amy is now running for mayor with a Yes in My Backyard campaign. It's a solutions-oriented approach to the issues and challenges facing San Francisco.
And I feel really fired up after listening to Tommy talk. That was great. And when who wants Bernie Sanders to come here in San Francisco and give a speech? Yeah, so we're excited about that. Right? I go to Richmond and help out with their mayor's race. So if you get involved with the mayor's race here, he might actually come out in support of us because we are the epicenter of this contract economy. We are the epicenter of the income inequity that he's talking about, right? He's saying, you know, 0.1% owns as much in America as the bottom 90%. Well, we're the epicenter of that in the country, right, in San Francisco. So it's really important for us to not say when Bernie shows up and says he's ready for a political revolution, and Bernie Sanders, you know, because of his amazing experience, but I have the same kind of experience of the last 20 years working for the same kind of issues that he was, and it's the same kind of dichotomy of a Hillary and Bernie kind of situation right now in San Francisco with Ed Lee, and then it's also Francisco, and Stewart has stepped up too in this guy, Reed Martin, and I think that it's really important for us to remember that the only way we're going to win this mayor's race is if we do what progressives initially intended to do in ranked choice voting, and we fill those three spots, and everybody can choose their order, but that's how we actually have a shot to do this. And you might also think, oh, this guy Stewart, why is he running? He's a joke. But guess what? About 40,000 people read his blog every week, and he might be able to activate a lot of people that don't normally vote. And you're saying that these votes are going to be decided on, you know, 6,000, 10,000, 15,000 votes? Well, then we actually have a shot, right? And when you think, I want you to sit back for a second and think about four more years of Ed Lee.
Oh.
That's how I felt in November, right? I was feeling that kind of despair after the Prop G loss and after the Compost 2 blood sport, money sport that happened, and it wasn't feeling good for me. And for me, the only antidote to despair is actually to take action, to be creative, to collaborate, to come up with solutions. And so I decided to do this. And why are we feeling despair? You know, I'm going to go ahead and say that we have class warfare going on in San Francisco. I'm going to go ahead and say that, but I wanted to maybe choose a different metaphor that works for us rather than saying class warfare, because I think I don't want this to be a battlefield. I want it to be a garden. I want this to be a thriving ecosystem. So what happens? What happens is that you have land and like mid-market or Western Addition or the Mission where these areas have become a little bit toxic in certain ways because there's been institutionalized racism. So the land starts to not be so healthy. And then you get this influx of culture makers and nonprofit workers and teachers and the people who can afford to live in these areas. And they actually, I can you tell I worked in a garden? I reactivated a dormant community garden in my neighborhood as a got this really cool diversity of crops. You know, it's great. You know, you got your okra, you got your kimchi, you got your kale. You have, you know, San Francisco, we got a lot of different styles here. We have pollinators coming in. We have the immune system of a mycelial network. Then what happens? Oh, we did the good work of making the soil healthy. So then, Chase Bank comes in. They caused the whole global financial collapse, right? But they decide, you know, I'm going to come into my neighborhood of the Visadero, and we're going to displace two local businesses in order to move in a bank 8 blocks away from another bank. That's how I got my start in local politics, working with Ian Preston, Quentin Mecca, Gus Hernandez. There was a sign saying, say no to Chase Bank. So I was riding my bike by it, and I was like, you know what? They just caused this global financial collapse. How is it that we're letting them displace two local businesses? I'm going to take a stand. And that's how I got activated. But, you know, this idea of Chase coming in, they see all these funky mushrooms like us around, right? And they're like, guess what? They just killed the whole immune system of the neighborhood because they're plucking out all of the things that are doing the good work to keep it healthy. Then they're planting their GMO monocrops. So, you know, use this metaphor of a garden. You know, this is an ecosystem. And we have these big corporations coming in, and they're picking out the very thing that is giving our garden its life and diversity and culture and flavor. So that's what's happening. I pushed back against that Chase Bank. I was so shocked that Ed Lee's administration, it was his Office of Economic and Workforce Development that said, they gave them the red carpet to come in, and they were supposed to be beholden to formula retail law, but they weren't for some reason. And so it was really disappointing, and I learned the zoning code. Learning zoning code hurts your brain a little bit at first, but if you have a good mentor like I did or a few, then you figure it out, you realize how it's all connected, and then we go up there, and that's what being a lawyer is, and that's what Ed Lee should be doing as a lawyer who was, you know, back in Chinatown with a community activist who was saying, you know, I could stop any eviction for a year. Where is he now? He says at the trans march that he's going to stop evictions. You know, come on. You've had 2 years to be doing that. Don't pander to us. Tell us how you're going to do it, because we don't understand how you're going to do it. We're at the epicenter right now, like I said, of this contractor economy. We're whittling away at the rights of our workers. We need to be figuring out what to do. San Francisco has a great history of breaking the law for some good things like, you know, getting people married, right, and gay rights. But then what have we been breaking the law for lately? We say that the Google buses don't need an environmental impact review to figure out what kind of impact that they're having. Why? You know, we do these giveaways. The Twitter giveaways, the same thing that happened in my neighborhood that happened on mid-market. That guy kept that storefront empty for 3 years in my neighborhood. Arizmendi's Bakery wanted to move in. A few other shops wanted to move in, but he kept it empty, the property owner. There's no tax or issue for him to keep it empty for 3 years and light it that way, and then Chase Bank gets to move in. The same thing happened on mid-market. Why was mid-market lighted? It was the property owners that weren't playing by the rules of the market. They were keeping things empty and taking a temporary loss, and then all of a sudden we give them the biggest cash cow that we can give them, and we reward them for that behavior. We need to be coming up with solutions. I'm going to close by saying, they're saying that it's going to be a cakewalk election for Ed Lee. I decided that the only way that we can combat not having a lot of money is to actually have a lot of creativity and a lot of enthusiasm and have fun with it. And so what I'm saying to do is we're going to have a cakewalk event in front of City Hall. And I'm asking people to go to mvformayor.com/cakewalk and take a survey. A lot of you I already gave these results to from 126 registered voters, but I'm asking people, tell me what the top issues you want me to debate and Francisco debate as your proxy with Ed Lee. I already have 126 people who have said what they want me to debate, and then I put 13 different issues down, which I'll pass out later. The top ones are running in San Francisco, inclusive and sustainable growth, short-term rentals, cultural preservation. These are the kind of things that we can't let this election slide without going toe-to-toe with Ed Lee and giving it our best effort. And like I said, we really need to come up with creative strategies and work together. I've been working together with Francisco since we both filed our nomination papers together the same day.
war and torture, and co-founder of the Oakland Catholic Worker House, where he assisted refugees from Mexico and Central America. He's a professional interpreter, and he uses those skills to participate in peacemaking efforts throughout Central America, Mexico, and parts of South America. He was co-founder of the SSA Labor Program, and he's lived in San Francisco since 1988.
Buenas tardes, Luis Herrera. I'm walking for mayor. I use the metaphor of walking because when we walk, we smell, we sense, we hear. I know 10 feet is impossible for us to beat Eddie. I think we can beat Eddie with Amy and Stuart. We're creating a card that says anyone but Lee, 1, 2, 3. You vote for your one. I'm putting myself as the one. I'm asking folks to put Amy as the number two, Stuart as the three, and they're going to do the same thing. We, Rancho's voting was created precisely to give the voter the power to choose. We are living in an oligarchy city moving towards a tyrannical city. And one of the first things that we need to change is precisely that structure. The Board of Supervisors really has no real power over the budget, and the budget is where the details are, and the love is in the details. As Buck, my good friend, veteran organizer, knows over here, you move money or you move people. What are we here? Are we money or are we people? Yeah. As Tim said, people are not just being moved out in the mission. People in the Sunset District have full-time jobs that hold foods or hold checks, as you call it, and are living in their cars. There's 27 children in one of the richest cities in the world, 2,700 children living in their cars or bunched up in sofas and in living rooms. Unfortunately, sisters and brothers, we are seeing San Francisco, the third world city, which it is now. San Francisco is a third world city with a chunk of very, very obscenely wealthy folks who made money off of our backs and a group of folks who don't have enough to live here. San Francisco needs at least 300 teachers in the school district who cannot afford to live here. So I won't repeat what our good brothers here have already said. The big problem that's happening here is political will and lack of planning. There is no plan that the Lee administration, call it Willie Brown, call it whoever you want to call it, there is no plan. There is no future. But the worst thing, as we've been engaging folks, is that our folks don't have a vision. And I would challenge you, Tim, to think that I think we can win. I think we can unseat at least. But we need you guys to think that too. But we don't only need you guys to think that. We need what Tommy said. We need to act on it. We need to be at every BART station. We need to be at every bus stop. We need to work as we already won. So our campaign, we're leading it in that way. We're working as we already won. What does that mean? When you already won, what the hell are you going to do, right? When you're a teacher, you confront your classroom, that's when you really realize, do I know what I said I knew, and how do I put it into practice? So we need to work. And starting now, like Tommy was saying, that's what we've been engaging part of. So we have four victory points. Unseating Ellie, winning the mayor's office. Two, November 3rd, we want to celebrate. We're going to celebrate a victory of establishing a citywide alliance of communities that have a plan, not a four-year plan, a 12-year plan. We need a real plan. And there's aspects of that plan already. There's a people budget that so many of us worked very hard to put together. There's a city master plan that has limits on heights that you can build that these people have been getting rid of. And there's a delusion that we need density. That's the big key word, density. Well, they don't have density in the mission. next 30 years. That needs to be our conversation. We keep leaving that conversation to the so-called developers who are not developers, they're destroyers. But we keep calling them developers. So what are they developing? Houses like our sister here said, for people who do not live here. 70% of city workers cannot vote in San Francisco because they don't live here. So how do we develop a plan? Land trust is one of the great solutions. The land belongs to us. We have to create a spot, like in the mission we've identified 13 sites where we can build decent housing, not towers of Babylon, decent housing up to 3 and 4 floors. You could build some city buildings from the downtown to the Ocean Beach that are no higher than 3 and 4 floors. You get your super density that the so-called people want. People don't want that density. Google, Facebook, the corporations that are moving people here. There is a horrible thing happening when I see Barbara Boxer, Dianne Feinstein, Ed Lee attacking the sanctuary ordinance that we worked so hard to put together. This is not an ordinance about dogs pooping on the sidewalk. This is an ordinance that saves lives, folks. We have to strengthen that. There are two of my brothers-in-law, 60,000 people in the last 6 years have been executed in the state of Chihuahua. 20,000 in Tijuana, in the city of Tijuana. 250,000, there's a war going on in Mexico right now. And if you're seeing the anxiety rise, it's because our relatives are thinking of their relatives. It's because what Tim was saying, our retiring baby boomers are saying, shit, man, I've been a teacher, I've been an enfermero, a nurse, I've been a firefighter all these years. When am I going to get a letter saying my bill has been sold? We can't sit like victims. Either we build a political will and across the city, across our neighborhoods, and on November 3rd, celebrate that. So that's our second victory. Celebrate that. Build right now, fight right now, learn who the hell runs what button, pushes what button, and pulls what lever in the city department. Block every planning commission meeting that doesn't respond. Every building that's going to have a planning commission has a big old sign or little sign on the street that says a date. Get the date. Get us all that. We are doing that as a campaign because we're running. We already won. So that's the third victory, to celebrate and to look at those ballot measures, not just the local ones, but guess what? White flight has gone statewide. Now they want to divide the state into 6 sections. Why? Because Latinos are a majority. So you create a little white flight section like the so-called Silicon Valley, which includes San Francisco, according to their little state map. So we need to fight that as well as if we were to win the changes on Prop 13, San Francisco would get up to $700 million a year. So let's plan forward. Let's have a vision. Let's create a vision of what San Francisco looks like in the next 20 years. Yes, you can live the next 20 years if you keep your health and exercise and daily good meals nutrition going. So that's where people might be saying, well, I'm not going to live. Is that we set the groundwork, apart from supporting Aaron Petkin, which I do, apart from supporting Mert Greenlee, which I do as well, apart from supporting the progressive folks, we can set the groundwork for getting a progressive majority in 2016. We got to get the vote out there. Last time, only 130,000 people approximately voted out of 600,000 available. We can get that voter red. We can get that 70%. A chunk of it to vote. Muchas gracias. Thank you very much.
The health message, that's right. So the majority of the questions. in, you can pick up a white card, focus on housing, voting, the mayoral race, and Airbnb. I want to start off by asking you, anybody who wants to take this. So I read the business sections regularly to learn more about what's really happening in San Francisco. And as most of you know, when a lot of these companies go public, they create millionaires overnight. Like 140 millionaires were created after Twitter went public. And again, a lot of people from overseas, it's mostly China, Canada, the UK, the four main countries. We did a show about this recently. And they're buying these $1.5 million one bedrooms, and then they're empty. So there's so much money being flooded. One friend said at one of the top floors of these high rises, they were going to have 10 units. But because the demand is so high, with people with so much money, they're going to have two units. The one facing the city is going to be $10 million, and the one facing the ocean will be, or the bay will be $20 million. So we're talking about a lot of money. And I just wonder, maybe Tim, you could give some solid policy for that. What are the main differences between what we are seeing and facing today versus the dot-com bubble in the 90s?
This is the dot-com bubble on a lot of steroids. San Francisco, no developer has a God-given right to build whatever they want in San Francisco. We don't have to approve that luxury hat. We can say to the developers, no, we don't want any more of this. That's okay. That's our right as a city. Okay? But right now, I don't see an imminent crash. I see this influx of investment capital and an influx of very wealthy people, and also somewhat wealthy people who are richer than most of us, moving here from someplace else to take high tech jobs. And I don't see that ending anytime soon, unless left to its own, left to the independent Adam Smith in the market, it's not going to change. It's going to get worse and worse and worse. The only thing that's going to change it is by the city actually using its powers as a municipality to plan, to zone, and to decide what we want and don't want.
So given that, we know what the problems are. What could NV realistically do to tackle specifically when it comes to affordable housing? Because according to SF Public Press, by the year 2022, San Francisco needs to build more than 16,000 new affordable units just to keep up with demand.
Let me speak to that really quickly, then let me go over to Tommy. All right, go back to the Hippocratic Oath. First, do no harm. All right, first, do no harm. First, don't give Twitter a tax break and have them bring in all of these extra high tech workers. Don't decide that we're going to do everything we can to attract tech firms when there's no place for their workers to live. All right? Second, roads should pay for growth. It's really simple. If you are going to build a headquarters for Salesforce in San Francisco, and that is going to attract 10,000 new employees, you should have to pay for housing for 10,000 people. And if you can't do that, if it doesn't pencil out, then go build your Salesforce headquarters in Detroit. There's nothing wrong with saying that. Right? So those are the two things that don't make things worse, and make sure that the people who are making money off of these projects are paying for the impact they create. We have city studies that show that every unit of market rate housing every 100 units of market rate housing create a demand for probably 40 or 50 units of affordable housing just by the market rate housing. That doesn't even include the demand that Twitter's putting up. That's just the housing itself creates that demand. So tell them, if you want to build market rate housing in San Francisco, fine. You can build 25 units of market rate housing and 75 units of affordable housing, or you can go away because that market rate housing isn't helping us anyway. Right? So Tommy has more about this than I do. That's my rant.
I agree with what Tim just said. I would add something that's going to sound really crazy at first, but think about this. I actually challenged Ron Conway at a meeting. I happened to be at a meeting at City Hall where the mayor called all these housing people together and tried to have this kumbaya moment where, you know, he got bankers and realtors and radical housing activists like myself and Ron Conway. This just unlikely crew of people in one room. It's the one that we didn't wind up killing each other. But at the end, and Ron Conway got up and did this whole grandstanding about, I feel for you folks. It's horrible what's happening to the city because of the tech industry. We don't need for this to happen. We're feeling your pain, blah, blah, blah. So I went up to him afterwards, and I said, you don't know me, but if you really mean what you said about wanting to help, here's what you can do. So three by mm-hmm. I said, you can call your buddies in the tech industry, raise $1 billion, which I know you can do in a few days, donate it to the community land trust, earmark it for rent-controlled buildings when they go up for sale, so that the land trust has a competitive edge to get those buildings, because right now it doesn't have a competitive edge, because speculators come in and they can outbid the land trust every day. So I said, give the land trust a competitive edge. The land trust can probably buy about 900 four-unit rent-controlled buildings, and in that way, we make an impact on the housing crisis by keeping people in their homes. Because that's the other thing that nobody really talks about in this housing crisis, is that basically we need to be protecting people, keeping their homes, and stopping the eviction. And the best way to stop the eviction is the land trust buys the building, the tenants form a co-op, they have permanently affordable housing for the rest of their lives.
And for the rest of the time.
Right, and for the rest of the time. It's permanently affordable. It's not like tax credit units, which run out in 30 years, and then the tenants get a rent increase up to market, you know, or some other form, or even BMRs, where it can be taken away from you, the affordability. So, Conway kind of just looked at me and said, that's interesting. And then he turned to the guy sitting next to him, which turned out to be Jeremy Wallenberg, who's his aide, who basically runs that city, which is their big charity organization. And he said, I want you to keep in touch with Jeremy, because it's kind of an interesting idea. I want you to have some conversations with him. So the land trust and myself have been having conversations with him. We tried to get money from him for Marty's place, which he didn't come through with, even though he promised us. But we're in conversation, and I'm not giving up on this idea. $1 billion is nothing for the tech industry. They are honestly the only ones who have the kind of money we need to buy back some of the land, to really make an impact, and to save a hell of a lot of people and allow them to continue living here. And it's not unrealistic, I think, for the mayor to go to his buddies and say, $1 billion this year and $1 billion next year. That's what I want.
What is the status of the land trust today? How many
land trusts?
I just wanted to know what the status of the land trust is today. How much money does it have? How much power does it have? I mean, can people get involved? I mean, a lot of people are just not learning about how it works.
The community land trust is a nonprofit entity that buys the land and leases it to the co-op for 99 years. The tenants form this co-op, a nonprofit. Tenants make all the decisions. They decide how much the rent is going to be raised, if they're going to be raised. They decide how they're going to get the money to fix the roof. The land trust is there to help them, support them, teach them the skills they need to, but they basically manage and are self-sufficient, and the place stays off the market, cannot be speculated on. It's affordable housing that's permanent. If you want to read about land trust, the best thing to do is go to Google. Google is Dudley Street Land Trust. It's a place in Boston, a neighborhood, a working class African American neighbor that took control of its neighborhood and basically brought themselves out of poverty and became a middle class neighborhood by using land trust and the power bank and domains they got from the city council. Read about it, I don't want to go into it.
What was the name of it?
It's a Dudley, D-U-D-L-E-Y. Dudley Street Land Trust, Boston.
And just to make it clear with land trust, in the rules of land control, the land belongs to us.
Right.
You can buy a building, and that's your building, and you're going to do whatever you're going to do with it, but the land belongs to the people of San Francisco. So Ed Lee actually has the power with the board to say, okay, speculators, sure, you can play with this 2-3% of a do your speculating thing, and we will control the land and the control based on what a healthy San Francisco looks like. We have that power, and Ed Lee has that power to do that.
If they wanted to, they could take the mission and land trust the whole mission if they wanted to, or the Castro, or Bayview. They could land trust it.
Yes.
Don't need to be too soon.
There's at least two culprits.
One thing that I want to add is that I was living in a house over in Colton and Mayan, and there were 9 of us that were living there, low income. We've been contributing to the value. Contributing to the value of the neighborhood for years and years and years, and the sale was going to go on. They originally bought the building for something around $500,000, and they ended up selling it for $2 million. I called up Tracy Parent, of the executive director of the land trust, and I said, you know, this Mother Teresa was actually in that building because it was a hospice for people with HIV and AIDS before the group of people that I knew moved into it. And so I said, this is the most amazing space. Let's go ahead and have the land trust help us. And guess what? It costs about 5 so they weren't giving us the money to be able to do it. We were on the short list, but we didn't get it. The other thing is that Ed Lee tomorrow could say, you know what, I want to get on the next ballot, is first right of refusal like they have in Washington, D.C. And if we had had that, I live in fear right now. I live with seven other people in an amazing co-op across from USF, and at any moment it could be sold, or they could actually raise the rent because it's not rent controlled. We had first right of refusal. That would give me just one little bit of hope that we could actually keep that. I want to also counter this idea, and we could talk about it more, but this idea that there aren't a lot of companies here that are just, they call them fat unicorns, you know, like they're getting invested in, but they're not really coming back with any kind of real real product, or, you know, it's kind of debatable as to whether or not they'll exist. Twitter doesn't really make a revenue. So when you're talking about five jobs created for every one tech job, and we have this 100,000 jobs that are read about in the Chronicle have been added since 2010, and like Tim is saying, and Tommy is saying, they didn't build the housing for that. There's no plan. And so we had, I really tie it back to Chase Bank and the collapse. And what happened in 2008 was we stopped building housing because of the collapse, and all of this stuff stopped, and only the city was building affordable housing. And what's going to happen now? They build all the luxury housing, and when's our next collapse going to happen? And then they're going to stop all the rest of the development. And so we really need to come up with different investment strategies. And Eric Marr is working on the pied-à-terre. He was trying to do the task or do something around that. I don't know where that stands right now. But we really need to, if Francisco or I are in the office, you're in the office, and we're going to come up with the ideas that we need and the creativity to be able to figure out how do we stop what you're talking about from happening.
I'll be supporting the day.
That's right. No, and that's a requirement. Just because you have a Ferrari that runs 150 miles an hour doesn't mean you could run it at 3 p.m. down Valencia Street at 150 miles an hour. There ain't no free lunch. This whole delusion about it's my right to do whatever the hell I want with my money, it's not true. It's not true, and we have to change that political delusionary thought that is happening, unfortunately, among many of our 20 and 30-year-olds. That just because you have a bunch of money, you could use it and step over people who built this city.
We have a question about the housing bond. What is the status of this bond? It's the $310 million bond.
It's on the ballot. Right, it will be on the ballot. It's going to be. We will be voting on that.
So this is $80 million for public housing, $150 million for low-income housing, and $80 million for middle-income housing.
Yes, that's the shape of it. It will be on the ballot. You know, sure. Why not? Let's have a housing bond. The thing that got me about this is the mayor says we're going to put up a housing bond that will not raise taxes. We can only do $310 million because that's the bond we paid off last year, so we won't raise any housing taxes. No, excuse me. If you own property in San Francisco right now, if you own a piece of property in San Francisco, unless you bought it 7 minutes ago, your property taxes are below inflation. That makes the property king. And I say this as somebody who's a homeowner in San Francisco. My property taxes are a tiny fraction of what they ought to be. All right, I bought my house 16 years ago. The property taxes are way too low, right? So, why can't we have a housing bond that raises taxes a little bit? $20 a month on, like, all of people who own property in San Francisco. Why is that such a radical idea? Why do we have to have a housing bond? Why don't we say, you know, property owners in San Francisco, more or less, by and large, are wealthier than everyone else. They should pay a little more taxes. Anyway, that's my view on the housing bond.
Do you think there should be any rules for people who are buying housing and not living in the house or the condo?
Yeah, and it's really hard to do because how do you tell?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How do you tell? This is the problem that we're being faced with.
How do you tell? How do you know who's living in the house?
Yeah, how do you know? I found out, the work I've done is I go around to these buildings and I wait until someone goes in and I follow them in. And then I go over to your house. And then eventually the security guard comes and tells me I have to leave, and I politely thank them and say I'm just a reporter trying to do some work, but I'll happily leave, and then I go to the next one.
That reminds me, I actually worked for the census when I was at SF State in 2010, getting my master's degree, and I was almost scared at how relentless these census workers were, because there were a lot of people that were out of work, and so these really intelligent people that were doing this work, and it was through that census work that we discovered that there were actual tens of thousands of unrented units, and I bet mentioned that in question time, like a few months ago, where you said, we have these vacant units, what do you do about them? That's a great question, and I'm not sure yet, but we should be putting effort into that.
You could tax vacant units, you could have them, but then you'd have to have a staff of housing inspectors walking around all these buildings, and, you know, you can do some of it by looking at the tax bill and seeing the tax bill goes to someplace other than the primary home, but then the person in Hong Kong may be renting it. So you really have to go and knock on doors, and it would be time intensive, but it's a fine idea.
We have a question about rent control. What else can be done about rent control? So currently, 72% of the 237,000 rental units are covered by rent control. Single-family homes, condos, and units built after 1979 are not covered, and there have been a lot of stories about rents doubling. I mean, you've probably read about all of this. Maybe it happened to some of you. So what would you do about rent control, and what can Ed Lee really do about rent control?
Well, we are tied by cost-to-pockets at the state level, and so it really does take a statewide political revolution in order for this to happen. We're talking about reforms for corporate corporations for Prop 13, but cost-to-pockets limits us in regards to that. So, you know, one of the things that I do think about in terms of a pilot program is when I think about what affordable rent is, I do think that it is, you know, like the federal government says, it's 30% of income, and I think for, you know, a lot of people it should be 30% of net income. But I do like this idea of thinking about, you know, I'm not afraid to do thought exercises about rent control and say, this is working, don't tamper with it right now, but is there a possibility of doing a pilot project of, can we think about how this could be more equitable without getting some knee-jerk reaction to it? Because I've been a renter, you know, ever since I moved out of my parents' house. I'm all for rent control, but maybe there is a way to do it more equitably. And I really want to look at and see what Richmond thinks about rent control. Thanks to some of our allies, right? And so it'd be interesting to see if there's any differences between their version and ours.
I haven't read their version, but the problem that we have here is that the state, Berkeley, Santa Monica, and West Hollywood used to have the rent control, where the rent control stayed when the apartment became vacant. Mm-hmm. Right? You rent an apartment out for $1,000 a month, that's the rent, plus a cost escalator forever. All right? Even if the tenant moves out. The landlords went absolutely crazy. They sued Berkeley. They took it all the way to the United States Supreme Court. They lost, right? And then, having lost in the United States Supreme Court, they went to the state legislature, and they tried to make the state legislature say, you can't do that anymore. And they lost year after year after year because there was one guy who was the president of the state senate who wouldn't let it happen in his watch because he represented West Hollywood. When he was turned out, they came right in and they overturned it. So now, you can't have rent controls on vacant apartments. Right. The state has limited our ability to do rent control. So there are some inherent unfairnesses to it. And that's because in the state legislature, even most of the Democrats are from Central Valley cities where rent control isn't really an issue. And we've just had a horrible time. So I hope, you know, that means we just have to be really, really creative about what we can do in San Francisco. And a lot of what we've been talking about, the anti-speculation tax, for example, was like, given the awful state laws that screw us up as a city, what can we actually get away with? So tell me, what do you think we can get away with in addition to rent control?
Well, I think one of the things that on Monday is going to be hearing about, what are they calling it now, eviction expansion?
Eviction control 1.0.
So it's a package of reforms of our just cause law to try to stop some of the tactics that landlords, particularly speculators, are using to get people out of their apartments, such as breach of lease. I mean, there was actually a speculator who bought a place in Chinatown and was evicting the tenants because they were hanging clothes on a clothesline that they'd been doing for years and years and years and years with the old landlord. But he was calling that a breach of lease, a violation of their lease. And there's all kinds of silly things like that they're doing, but they're managing to succeed in a lot of cases because people don't know their rights, people are scared. If they're immigrants, they're scared out of their minds because they're afraid that immigration is going to be called. And I hear that all the time in my office because I speak Spanish. I had Spanish immigrants saying to me, it was, you know, my building was sold, this realtor came to the door and said, if I don't leave by the end of the month, they're going to call the media, they're going to call immigration on. And even if people, and first of all, you know, they make the assumption just because they're Spanish, let's say, and you speak Spanish, you're automatically undocumented, which is a documented or not, they're scared. And they don't want to fight the system. And I assure them that they can fight and that they don't have to leave and blah, 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 but people are scared. So we're seeing all these kinds of evictions, phony, owner movement evictions, that I mean, when you see the notice, when it comes to my office, it's like you look at it and go, oh, no way. No way is this going to fly. But again, people are scared to fight. When they do fight, people are waiting against these phony notices. So what we have is a package of bills that's going that Jane Kennedy is going to do to kind of clean up some of that and close some of the loopholes that landlords can't get them. Speculators. I can't say landlords, not landlords, but speculators. Because they can't get away with so many taxes.
You know, one other thing we can do that the mayor started to do a little bit, just a little bit, is, you know, in San Francisco, anywhere in the United States, if you're charged with a crime and you don't have any money, you're guaranteed a lawyer. We could say that in San Francisco, if you're facing eviction, you're guaranteed a lawyer.
Yeah.
Right. And what would it cost? $20 million a year to like fund enough of anti-eviction lawyers that every poor person who gets an eviction is, it's not that expensive. I mean,
they are overworked, the ones that we have.
They are, yeah, they are. But that's what I'm saying. If we had like $20, $30 million a year more, to
hire more.
We could hire a lot more. And honestly, you know, like reporters, anti-eviction lawyers are not that expensive. I mean, there's people. It's true. I mean, you know, and I'm on the board of legal assistance to the elderly. It's horrible. But we pay our lawyers like $50,000 or $60,000. This is not a $20 million thing. This is not like high-end thing. We could do it with a little bit of money. And in fact, they were talking about that. And you know what happened? It got to the budget committee. And Mark Farrell, the chair of the budget committee, said, no, I'm not going to put any more money into this. You know why? Because all of you housing groups come down to City Hall with 1,000 people and bother me.
Yeah.
Literally.
Exactly.
That's literally what they said. So I'm not going to fund you. But with a little bit of money, I mean, you know, a fraction of what we spend on the cops and the fire department and all this other stuff, a little bit of money, we could fully fund a program where everybody who faces an eviction has a lawyer assigned to them. And that was number one.
So now we know we got to get Farrah out.
The other
thing is, once again, planning. Planning together. San Francisco, we have a lobbyist in Sacramento. And we have representatives in Sacramento that we have to be clear about. As mayor, that's what we would be doing, saying, lobbyists, this is your job. We got to get rid of this rent control blockage that is not letting us operate as a healthy city. Mark Lano, et cetera, you guys, you have a job that you have to do. If they don't do it, we have to work to get them out and do it and get people who do that job. Planning, vision, focus, and execution. You all know this is the process. I think another piece that goes with rent control, by the way, on the issue of this rent control piece, a small example of community education and passing the word. The Archdiocese of San Francisco put out, through their concerns office, put out a little leaflet saying, if you're getting evicted, call this number. 606 London Street in Excelsior. One getting, three families living in one house, getting evicted. Three of them in handicapped. And they're getting, again, another of these phonies, probably an illegal eviction happening. Well, they got the sheet of paper, they called the diocese, they got the thing going, and now they're fighting the eviction. They would have been out last week. They're fighting, surviving. But another piece is affordability. We, like Tim was saying, we tax the big companies. They can actually become heroes. Throw them Google buses out of the neighborhood, tax them, fund in a good way muni. We all get to, I won't say free muni because we already paid for it, but at zero of muni, or as they say, free muni, we all benefit as working people. But what you got going right now is a double class within the working class, right? You get these super little IT buses for the chosen folks who've been brought in from other places, and the rest of us get not that much bad of a muni, but the rest of us get muni. They could actually tax the company, and we could all